going to continue the chapter number 4, effects of electric current, module 3. In the first module, we studied energy transfer in an electrical circuit. In the second module, that means yesterday, we finished heating effects of electric current. And today, in the third module of the chapter, we will acquire knowledge of magnetic effects of electric current. So before starting magnetic effects of electric current, let's take a quick recap of heating effect of electric current that we studied yesterday. So yesterday we studied that when an electric current it flows through a wire, the wire gets heated. This is called heating effect of electric current. And the factors which affect the amount of heat produced are the electric current flowing through the circuit, the resistance, and the time for which electric current flows. And all these three things, they are correlated by the help of formula H is equal to I square RT. And this is also called as Joule's law of heating. By this formula, we can calculate the amount of heat produced in a given circuit. Then we studied applications of heating effects of electric current. So most of the household electrical appliances that we use at our home, they convert electrical energy into heat by the heating effect of electric current. So most of the common devices that we use are filament lamps, electrical heater, electrical iron, electrical kettle, etc. So in electrical heaters, basically we need heat energy. So electric heaters, you can see the iron, electric heater, electric toaster, they are the some most common home appliances that utilize heating effect of electric current. So at that place where we need large amount of heat to be produced in that appliance, we need a element which is made up of nichrome, which have high resistance power and which can emit large amount of heat at the same time. So here nichrome wire, which is an alloy of nickel and chromium, is used as a heating element, or you can say to make the coil of the appliance. In the same way, in electric lamp, what we need light energy, right? We need electrical energy to be converted into light energy. So here we need a tungsten filament which has a high melting point of nearly 3380 degrees Celsius, which is kept inside a glass bulb and it heats up and gives light energy to us. So in this light energy also, out of the 100% of the electrical energy, only 5% of the electrical energy gets converted into light energy. Rest of the 95% of the energy is wasted as a heat energy that we don't need it. So this is the disadvantage here. Then we studied the next application of heating effect of electric current was the electric fuses. They are used in our domestic electrical circuit to protect our home with the excess flow of current. Okay, so electrical fuses, they are connected in series. This point you have to remember, that the electrical fuses, they are connected in series in a circuit to protect the electric devices from the heat developed by the passage of excessive current. It is a short length of wire made up of low melting point material. It melts and breaks the circuit if current exceeds a certain level. Lead and copper wire melts and burns out when the current increases above 5 ampere and 35 ampere respectively. What are the uses of fuse? Fuses are used when the current in the circuit exceeds the specified maximum safe value of circuit due to short circuit, overload, okay, and in insulation breakdown. In all these cases, your fuse is used to protect the you can say the building or the house from the excessive flow of current, because it can lead to fire. Then we studied advantages, or you can say which are the good things in the heating effect, how we can utilize it. So we can make electric light bulbs like CFLs, make toaster, electric heater for cooking. We can make room heaters to make our room warm during cold seasons. We can make electrical fuses. We can make electrical appliances like electrical iron, immersion rod, electric kettles, hair dryer, geyser, water heating coils, electric heater, etc. Now, along with the advantages, there are some disadvantages of the heating effect also. So the disadvantages are there. It reduces the life of several components in a circuit. Heat produced causes wastage of energy. It causes short circuits and explosions. It causes fires and circuit failure. It's dangerous if electrical appliances are not handled properly. Additional cooling systems and heat sinks need to be added to the circuits to counter the effect of heating, which adds to the cost. Okay, so that's all about the previous lecture which we studied yesterday. Now let's start today's topic, that is the magnetic effect of electric current. So when we hear the word magnetic, so the simple thing which comes in our mind, or the automatically the image of a magnet, it comes in our mind. So let's recall some properties of magnet, because the magnetic effect of electric current is somewhat like magnet. So as you can see, this is a magnet. So what is a magnet? Materials that can exert forces on magnets or other magnetic materials like iron and steel, they are called magnets. Magnets, they are very commonly used. You can see the magnet in the door of the refrigerator, the doors of the cupboards, right? So at that places, the magnets are used. Now, what are the types of magnet? Depending upon the shape of a magnet, there are different types of magnets. For example, you can see on the screen, this is the bar magnet, which is rectangular in shape. Then ring magnet, it is like a ring. Then this is a horseshoe magnet. Then it is a magnetic needle. Then it is a disc magnet. Now let's understand some properties of a magnet. So you have already studied in your previous standards. A magnet has two poles, north pole and south pole. North pole is represented by capital N, south pole is represented by capital S. And the poles of a magnet, they always exist in pair. You can't separate them. For example, if you want to break this magnet into two pieces and you want to try to separate the north and south pole of this magnet, so it is not possible. Why it is not possible? When you break them into two pieces, the other end of the magnet, it automatically generates the opposite pole. For example, if you separated the north pole here, on the other end, automatically the south pole will be generated. In the other part, south pole is already present, so north pole will be automatically generated here. So whatever you are going to break down it into many pieces, then each and every piece will automatically generate the other pole. So you can't separate these two poles. They are always existing in pairs. Then the third property is that unlike poles, they attract each other. As we have already studied that positive and negative charges, they are opposite charges and they attract each other. The same thing is also here. The opposite poles, you can say the south pole and the north pole, they will attract each other. Okay. In the same way, the same poles, or you can say the same charges like positive, positive, negative, negative, they repel each other. In the same way, the same poles like north, north, if you bring the two magnets with the north, north poles together, they will repel each other. They will move away from each other. In the same way, if you take south, south pole together, they will also show the same repulsion property. So the same poles, they repel each other, and unlike poles, they attract each other. Then the one more important property of magnet is that if a magnet is suspended freely, if you suspend a magnet freely, it aligns itself in north-south direction. It always, the north always shows towards the north direction and south pole always shows the south direction. They never go in the east or west direction or any direction. Okay, they always align themselves along the north and south direction of the earth. These are the all five important properties of a magnet. Now, what is a magnetic field? So the region surrounding a magnet in which the force of magnet can be experienced is called a magnetic field. As we studied and we have saw that when we take a magnet and bring it closer to a magnetic substance like an iron nail, it attracts it. But the force of attraction is also up to a particular area. Right, so the area, you can say, or the region surrounding a magnet in which the force of magnet can be experienced. If you are going to take the magnet away from the iron nail, it will not attract it. But if you are going to bring it closer, then only it can experience the force. That means the magnet, it has some area around it in which you can experience the force. So that area is called as a magnetic field. So the definition here says the region surrounding a magnet in which the force of magnet can be experienced is called its magnetic field. So in the same way here, the magnetic field, it can be visualized by using magnetic field lines. The patterns of magnetic field lines tell us the shape of magnetic field. Now the question arises, how can we find the shape of the magnetic field? There are two ways, using the iron filings or a magnetic compass. Here we are going to find the shape of the magnetic field by using iron filings. Now let's do an activity in which we have to draw the magnetic field. Actually, magnetic field, it is a kind of force. We can't see it, but we can experience it. So here we draw imaginary lines to show the magnetic field of a magnet. So for this, let's see what materials we are going to need. So here we can see we need a bar magnet. We need some iron filings. Iron filings means the small pieces, or you can say powder form of iron. A piece of paper. Then what we have to do, we have to take the piece of paper. On this piece of paper, we have to keep the bar magnet. And around the bar magnet, we have to sprinkle the iron filings. And gently, we have to tap the paper. After tapping the paper, we will observe a pattern around the magnet. And that pattern is called as the magnetic field of the magnet. Let's see the magnetic field. You can see such kind of lines formed around the magnet. So the lines along which the iron filings arranged, they are called as the magnetic field of lines. You can see some of the semicircular lines here. These are the magnetic field of magnetic field lines. They are called as magnetic field lines, and they originate from the north pole and they end up at the south pole. Automatically the iron filings, they will arrange in such pattern. So this shows that how the magnetic lines of forces, they are arranged around the magnet. Now let's see some properties of the magnetic field lines. So the magnetic field lines show the direction and strength of the magnetic field. So from these magnetic lines, you can see these semicircular lines, what they tell us? They tell us the direction of the magnetic field, and they tell us the strength of the magnetic field. Strength of the magnetic field means how strong will be the magnetic field, how strong you will feel the force of attraction around the magnet. So the first case, we are going to learn about the direction of magnetic field. So in the direction of magnetic field, you can see here in the magnetic lines of forces, the arrow is shown here. This arrow shows the direction of the magnetic field. It shows that the magnetic field lines, they always originate from the north pole and they end up at the south pole. All the lines, they are originating from the north pole and they are going inside the south pole. This is the first property. And inside the magnet, the direction is from the south pole to the north pole. So it's a like a circular ring. It starts from the north pole, it goes into the south pole, and then inside the bar magnet, it goes from the south pole to the north pole. Thus the field lines, they form a closed loop. They form a closed loop. And the second next property is that the field lines, they never cross or intersect each other. You can see these field lines, they are not crossing each other or intersecting each other. This is the most important property of magnetic field lines. Now let's see the strength of magnetic field. The closeness of the magnetic field lines tell us about the strength of the magnetic field. That means if the magnetic lines of fields are closer to each other, at that place the magnetic field will be stronger. So you can see at the north pole and at the north pole and at the south pole, the magnetic field of lines are closer to each other. This shows that the magnetic force will be strong at the north pole and at the south pole. Okay, so if you are going to bring a iron particle closer to the magnet, you will experience greater force at the south pole and at the north pole as compared to the other parts of the magnet. Then next says, as the lines, they spread out, you can see at these places they are spread out, they are away from each other. This shows that the magnetic field is weaker here. So we can say that the magnetic field, it is strong at the poles, both the poles of the magnet, and at the other places it is weaker. Now, do you know that Earth also has a magnetic field around it? It seems that Earth has a bar magnet placed inside it, but actually there is no real magnet inside the Earth. So how does the Earth get its magnetism? It is due to the magnetic field of electric current. So does the electric current flows inside the earth? The electric currents are due to the motion of convection currents of molten iron in the earth's outer core, and the electric current produces magnetism. As you know that inside the earth, earth is divided into three parts. The internal part is called as core. Inside the earth's core, molten iron is present. And this flow of these molten iron, it produces a current, and because of that electric current, magnetism is developed. So the earth is like a huge electromagnet. So magnets, they are used in so many things. For example, fridge, magnet, speaker, earphones, hard drives of computer. Now we know about the electric current and magnetism. So let's start magnetic effect of electric current, or we can say that how electric current and magnetism are related to each other. Observe the following pictures. Do you know what is common to these things? You can see here, this is a maglev train. This is a crane lifting iron junk. This is an electric bulb. This is MRI machine. All these devices, they work on the magnetic effect of electric current. So magnetism, it is known since ancient times. Electricity, it was discovered in 1700s, but later in 1820, a scientist named Hans Christian Oersted discovered very interesting phenomena. He was the first scientist who proved that electric current and magnetism are related to each other. So, he played an important role in understanding electromagnetism. Don't get confused. Magnetic effect of electric current and electromagnetism, both are same. In his honor, the unit of intensity of the magnetic field is termed as Oersted. Okay, so he conducted an experiment. So let's see what experiment he did. In 1820, Oersted established the relationship between electricity and magnetism. He told that the electricity and magnetism, they are related to each other. They are not independent things. So he concluded that a current carrying wire produces a magnetic field around it. As we saw, a current carrying conductor produces heat. In the same way, a current carrying conductor, it also produces magnetic field around it. So what was the aim of his experiment? His aim was to show that a current carrying wire, it produces a magnetic field around it. And what are the things required for his experiment setup? A thick insulated copper wire is taken and connected with a battery in such a way that current flows from the south to north direction in the wire, and a compass needle is placed under the wire. Let's see the circuit diagram of his experiment. You can see here, there is a thick copper wire. It is connected to a battery. This is the switch to on off the flow of current. And this is a magnetic needle. This magnetic needle, it can move freely. As you can see, it aligns always in the north and south direction. So it shows north and south direction. So when the current is switched off, you can see the switch is not connected. It is open. So circuit is open. The current will not flow. So as you can see here, when the current is not flowing in the circuit, there is no deflection in the compass needle. The compass needle is aligning itself in north and south direction. But when the electric current is passed through the wire, we connected the wire here, connection is on now. Electric current will flow from the positive end of the battery to the negative end. So here your current is flowing from the south direction to the north direction. So in that case, what happens, this magnetic needle, or you can say the compass needle, it gets deflected towards the west direction. Then in the next case, on reversing the direction of current, now what I did, I reversed the battery. Now I changed the terminals. Previously, the positive terminal was on the left-hand side. Now, I turned it towards on the right-hand side. So, because of inverting the battery, the direction of the current will also be reversed. Now, the current will start flowing from the north direction to the south direction. In this case, when the direction of current is changed, the direction of magnetic needle to be deflected, it also changes. Previously, it was moving towards the west direction. Now it is moving towards the east direction. So what we conclude from this experiment, that the deflection of compass needle whenever there is a current in the circuit wire shows that a current carrying wire produces a magnetic field. That's why the magnetic needle is deflecting, na? Otherwise, when the current was not flowing, it doesn't show any deflection. So when the current was flowing in the circuit, it develops a magnetic field around it as the bar magnet develops. And because of that magnetic field, this magnetic needle, it experiences a force, and because of which it shows deflection. So we can say that this current carrying wire, it is acting as a magnet. Okay, so it is acting as a magnet. So Oyster concluded that when electric current flows in a conductor, it behaves like a magnet, and a current carrying wire creates a magnetic field around it, and this is the magnetic effect of electric current or electromagnetism. In other words, electricity is producing magnetism. So previously the electric current and magnetism, they were considered separately, but after Oyster's experiment, we know that both are linked together. So electricity, now we know that electricity can produce magnetism. Now we know that a current carrying conductor produces magnetic field around it. Here the shape of magnetic field, it depends upon the shape of the current carrying conductor. Now we will discuss properties of magnetic field produced by conductors of different shapes. You can see on the screen there are three different shape conductors. The first one is a straight conductor. You can see this is a straight conductor, or you can say it is a straight wire. The second one is a circular loop. I bent this straight conductor and converted into a circular loop. Then third one, it is a solenoid. Solenoid, it is nothing but take a straight wire and rotate it like a spring. This is a spring shaped conductor and it is called as solenoid. So we have to study now how the magnetic lines of forces, they are produced by these three different shapes of conductor. So one by one we will observe all these three shapes. Let's start with the straight conductor, that is a straight wire. So you can see here, connect the circuit as shown in the figure. You can see there is a straight conductor taken here, and this is straight conductor. It is connected to a key to switch on or off the current flowing in the circuit. Then it is connected to a battery, and then it is connected to a ammeter. Ammeter, it measures the amount of current flowing in the circuit. Then there is a variable resistance. The use of variable resistance is to change the amount of current flowing through the circuit whenever it is required. With the help of variable resistance, you can increase the amount of current flowing in the circuit, you can decrease the amount of current flowing in the circuit. Okay, so in this way the connection is done here. And here you can see there is a white cardboard. This white cardboard, it is used here, and the conducting wire is passed through it. And what is done here, it sprinkles some fine iron filings around it. On this cardboard, sprinkle some iron filings around it, as we have done in the bar magnet in the same way. So what happens here, when we switch on this, the current starts flowing in the circuit. When the current starts flowing in the circuit, the iron filings, they get arranged around the conductor in concentric circles, which denotes the shape of magnetic field lines around the straight current carrying wire. Concentric circles, you can see all these circles, they have a same center. That is the wire. This is the center of all the circles. So as the center of all these circles is same, it is called as concentric circle. So the magnetic field lines, they are arranged around a straight conductor in the form of a concentric circle. You can see here, iron filings, they have arranged around this conductor in concentric circles, small circles, then around them big circles, you can observe here. So what are the characteristics of magnetic field due to a current carrying conductor? It encircles the conductor. It is encircling the conductor. It is around the conductor. It lies in a plane perpendicular to the conductor. You can see here, this is the conductor, and the magnetic lines are arranged on the cardboard, and the angle between them is 90 degrees. So So that's why it is said that it lies in a plane perpendicular to the conductor. And the reversal in direction of current flow reverses the direction of the field also. So if we change the direction of current in this conductor, the direction of field will also be changed. And the next comes here, the strength of the field. The strength of the field is directly proportional to the magnitude of the current. That means if we increase the flow of current in the conductor, the strength of magnetic field will be stronger. And if we decrease the amount of current in the conductor, the strength of magnetic field will also decrease. Thus, other thing on which the magnetic field depends is the distance of the point from the wire. For example, if you are going to find out the magnetic field or magnetic strength nearby the conductor, you will feel more strong magnetic field around it. But if you are moving away from the conductor, so you can see the distance from the conductor is increasing. So it is inversely proportional to the distance. More the distance, weaker will be the magnetic field. As you are moving away from the conductor, the magnetic field will be weaker and weaker and weaker. Okay, so we studied that magnetic field, it depends on two things. First one is the current, more strongest magnetic field. Then it depends on the distance, inversely proportional to the distance. Larger the distance, weaker is the magnetic field. These two points you have to remember, because in one mark question, that kind of questions can be asked. Now, there is a right hand thumb rule, it tells us if we know the direction of the magnetic field in a straight conductor, we can find out the direction of magnetic field. It is also called as Maxwell's right hand thumb rule. For this, you have to use your right hand, and it indicates the direction of magnetic field if the direction of current is known. According to this rule, if we grasp the current carrying conductor in our right hand, you can see how we have grasped it. So that our thumb points in the direction of the current. Our thumb should be in the direction of current. Okay. And so that our thumb points in the direction of current, the direction in which our fingers encircle the wire will give the direction of magnetic field lines around it. You can see in this direction the fingers are curled. So magnetic fields, they are coming in the same direction. You can see the direction in which the fingers are curling in the same direction, the magnetic field will be there. So magnetic fields are also coming outside from the inside. This is the direction of magnetic field. So when the thumb points upwards, the curled fingers are anti-clockwise. You can see it is anti-clockwise. So the direction of magnetic field is also anti-clockwise. And if we reverse the direction of current, now you can see the current is flowing downwards. The current is flowing downwards. So in this case, what happens? You curl the finger, thumb will point towards the direction of the current. Now the finger is curled clockwise. So here the magnetic field will also be clockwise direction. So you can remember here, if the current is flowing in upward direction, the direction of magnetic field will be anti-clockwise. And when the direction of current is downwards, the direction of magnetic field will be clockwise. Okay, so this is all about the straight conductors, and we have learned that a current carrying wire acts as a magnet. But have you ever experienced this behavior? Yes, have you ever experienced this behavior in your daily life? Okay, so now let's see here, the Maxwell's right hand thumb rule, it is also called as right hand thumb rule, it is also called as Maxwell corkscrew rule. It is not in your syllabus. Just for extra information, I have used here. So it says that if right hand screw is turned so that it moves forward in the same direction as the conventional go inside, and this shows the direction of the current, and the direction in which we are rotating the nail, this shows the direction of magnetic field. This is called as Maxwell's corkscrew rule and Maxwell's right hand thumb rule. They are not different from each other. So in your syllabus, it is the right hand thumb rule only. So what I asked is, you have experienced this behavior, magnetic effect of electric current, as we just studied that a current carrying conductor, it experiences a it generates a magnetic field around it. So you can see the wire that we use for charging our mobiles, charging our laptops, they are also a current carrying conductor now. So they should also develop a magnetic field around it. But if we take a nail around nearby these wires, does it attract it? No, it doesn't attract it. Why it doesn't attract it? It should act as a magnet, right? Why it doesn't attract it? Because the magnetic field produced by the wire is very weak. Because the current flowing in the wire is not enough to create the strong magnetic field around it. Here the current flowing in the wire, it is very weak. So it develops a magnetic field around it, but the magnetic field is very weak. And it is not sufficient to attract magnetic materials like an iron nail or steel pins, right? Now, look at the pattern of magnetic field due to a circular loop. If we take a straight wire and bend it in a shape of a circle, it forms a circular loop. You can see the wire, the straight wire, it is now bent up in the form of a circular loop, and it is connected to a battery, to a ammeter, and to a resistor. It is exactly same as we studied in straight conductor. Only the shape of the conductor is changed here. Rest of the things are same. So our circuit is completed by connecting various components as shown in the figure. So if the current passes through the loop, the magnetic lines of force are produced at each point on the loop. You can see when the current is passing here from this side, from P to Q. You can see here, if a cardboard is taken and we sprinkle some iron filings around it, we will observe that around this part of the wire also, it will develop a magnetic field around it, and it will also show a concentric circle as we have seen in straight conductor. And the other part on the other side also, we will observe some concentric circles around it. So this is the arrangement of magnetic lines of force around a circular loop. So if the current passes through the loop, magnetic lines of force are produced at each point of the loop, not only at point P and Q. At each point of the loop, such kind of concentric circles, or you can say magnetic field, you will observe. As we go away from the wire, the concentric circles representing the magnetic lines of forces will become bigger and bigger, because you can see here, nearby the conductor, the magnetic field lines, they are making small circles. But as we are moving away from it, the circles, they are increasing in their size. Bigger and bigger circles we are observing here. So as we go towards the center of the loop, and if we move towards the center of the loop, the circle becomes so big that its arcs can be shown as a straight line. The magnetic lines of force are shown near the points P and Q only. However, they will create near each point on the loop. You can see at each point of the loop, you will observe magnetic field of lines forming concentric circles around it. So the whole conductor, or you can say the whole circular loop, will develop a strong magnetic field around it. Likewise, each point will produce magnetic field at the center of loop. So you can see here the magnetic field from this part of the conductor and the magnetic field from this part of the conductor, they will add up at the center, and after adding it up, you can feel a stronger magnetic field around it. So at the center of the loop, the magnetic field lines, they are straight. Each segment of circular loop carrying current produces magnetic field lines in the same direction with the loop. And the direction of magnetic field at the center of circular coil is perpendicular to the plane of the coil, that is along the axis of the coil. And here the direction of magnetic field of every section of the circular loop can be found by using the right hand thumb rule. Here also you can use the right hand thumb rule. You can hold the conductor with the help of your right hand, and the thumb will show the direction of current, and the direction of curling of fingers, they will show the direction of the magnetic field. So you can use the right hand thumb rule for this conductor also. All the magnetic field lines add up at the center and make the magnetic field stronger. So if we compare the magnetic field produced by a straight conductor and a circular coil, we will observe that द स्ट्रॉन्गर मैग्नेटिक फील्ड इज प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय अ सर्कुलर कॉइल एज कंपेयर टू अ स्ट्रेट कंडक्टर. व्हाई? बिकॉज इन अ स्ट्रेट कंडक्टर वी विल ऑब्जर्व ओनली अ सिंगल काइंड ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड अराउंड अ सिंगल स्ट्रेट कंडक्टर. बट हियर बिकॉज ऑफ द शेप वी के एट द सेंटर द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड फ्रॉम दिस साइड एंड द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड फ्रॉम दिस साइड ऑफ द कंडक्टर दे एड अप एंड दे विल इंक्रीज द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड एट द सेंटर ऑफ द कॉइल. देन वॉट आर द फैक्टर्स अफेक्टिंग द स्ट्रेंथ ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड? फर्स्ट वन इज द अमाउंट ऑफ करेंट थ्रू द वायर. सो एज वी स्टडीड दैट द अमाउंट ऑफ करेंट थ्रू द वायर इट इज डायरेक्टली प्रोपोर्शनल टू द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड. मोर द करेंट फ्लोइंग थ्रू द सर्किट हायर विल बी द और यू कैन से द स्ट्रॉन्गर विल बी द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड. देन हेयर रेडियस ऑफ द सर्कुलर लूप इट इज इनवर्सली प्रोपोर्शनल टू द रेडियस. बिगर इज द रेडियस वीकर विल बी द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड. देन नंबर ऑफ टर्न्स इन द सर्कुलर वायर. सो हेयर वी हैव ड्रॉन ओनली अ सिंगल वायर. सो इफ वी इंक्रीज द नंबर ऑफ टर्न्स ऑफ दीज सर्कुलर लूप्स द अमाउंट ऑफ करेंट फ्लोइंग ईच लूप विल बी इंक्रीज. Along with that, the amount of magnetic lines of forces produced from them will also be increased. And as a result, the magnetic field, or you can say the magnetic strength, will also increase. If we increase the number of loop 5 times, the magnetic field will also be 5 times stronger. So if number of turns in a circular coil are increased, magnetic field at the center of loop increases. So we can enhance the strength of magnetic field by increasing the number of circular loops. So magnetic field of a circular loop is stronger than that of a straight wire. Understood? So here, a current carrying a circular wire, it behaves like a thin disc magnet. I think all of you have seen such kind of disc magnets. They are easily available. They are the most commonly used magnet shapes and the most versatile. They are used in holding appliances like fridge magnets. You have seen such kind of decorative fridge magnets. They are used and we use them to stick on the fridge. If we flip the fridge magnet, on the back side of the fridge magnet, we can see disc magnets at the back. So our circular, you can say the circular loop, it also acts like a disc magnet because it also have a circular shape. So one end of this disc magnet, it acts as a north pole and the other side it acts as a south pole. Okay, I think all of you understood about this. Now let's come to the third shape, that is solenoid. Magnetic field due to a current in a solenoid. So you can see when a copper wire with a resistive coating is wound in a chain of loops like a spring, it is called a solenoid. You can see the image here. This is the image of a solenoid. Each turn of the solenoid is a current carrying circular loop. So each circular loop is producing a magnetic field around it. So the magnetic field of these turns add up to produce a strong magnetic field of the solenoid. Let's see here. So when an electric current, it flows through a solenoid, you can see the wire is turned in the form of a spring and it is connected to a battery. So when the current starts flowing in this circuit, it develops a magnetic field and similar to the bar magnet. One end of the solenoid, it acts as a north pole and the other as a south pole. You can see here, if we compare the circular loop and this solenoid, in a circular loop, we saw a single ring. But here the whole wire, it is coiled like circular loop. So we can say that here so many circular loops are joined together. And if we are talking about the properties of the magnetic field produced by a solenoid, they are very similar to the magnetic field produced by a bar magnet. In bar magnet, we studied that a bar magnet has a north and south pole. In the same way, on a solenoid, it also develops a north and south pole around it. You can see here, it is a north pole and it is a south pole. And we studied that the magnetic lines of forces, they originate from the north pole and they end up at the south pole. Right? And these magnetic lines of forces, they are closer at the poles, that is at north pole and south pole, due to which the magnetic field, or you can say the magnetic strength, is stronger at the poles. And as we move away from the magnet, we can see here in between the north and south pole, magnetic lines of forces, they are away from each other, and because of which the magnetic strength is weaker here. the magnetic lines of force inside the solenoid are parallel to each other. You can see here, inside the solenoid, the magnetic lines of forces, they are parallel to each other. This means that the intensity of magnetic field within the solenoid is uniform everywhere. That means the magnetic field inside the solenoid is uniform. It is same everywhere. But if we are going to come outside the solenoid, it is stronger at the poles and it is weaker at the other parts where the magnetic lines of forces, they are away from each other. This is the bar magnet and this is the solenoid. If we are going to compare them, we can see the similar magnetic lines of forces around them. That's why it is said that the solenoid, it has the same magnetic lines of forces as a bar magnet. It shows similarities as with the bar magnet. Now, how can we change the strength of a magnetic field of a solenoid? Again, the same thing. It depends on the current, directly proportional to the current. More current, stronger magnetic field. By increasing the number of turns in the solenoid, more turns in the solenoid, more stronger will be the magnetic field. Then by placing a soft iron core, so in this figure we have seen that it is hollow inside. We just encircle it like a spring, right? There is nothing inside it, but we can increase the strength of magnetic field around the solenoid by inserting a soft iron core inside it. So solenoid plus soft iron core, it is called as electromagnet. Now magnets, we have studied there are two types. One is a permanent magnet and other is the electromagnets. Permanent magnets, they are made up of steel and alloys such as carbon steel, chromium steel or alnico. And where they are used? Permanent magnets, they are used in fridge magnets, toys, microphones, loudspeakers, etc. But electromagnets, they are made using a long insulated copper wire wrapped around a soft iron. And they are used in electric bell, maglev train, MRM machines, etc. So they are permanent magnets, but these electromagnets, they are not permanent magnets. They act as a magnet only when electricity is passed through them. As you switch off the electricity, they will not act as a magnet. So that's why they are called electromagnets. They behave as magnets when the electricity is passed through them. Now let's see some differences between permanent and electromagnets. In permanent and magnets, magnetism is permanent unless damaged. Till the magnet is not damaged, its magnetism will be permanent. In electromagnets, magnetism is temporary and can be switched on or off. Just passing electricity, it will act as a magnet. We switch off the current, it will not act as a magnet. It's a temporary. Then permanent magnets, their magnetic fields are weaker, they are not very strong. But electromagnets, they are much stronger. In permanent magnets, the strength of the magnetic field, it cannot be changed. But in electromagnets, we can change the magnetic field. How? We just studied by increasing the amount of flow of current in the circuit, by increasing the number of turns, by inserting an iron core in the solenoid, we can enhance the strength of magnetic field. Then polarity is fixed. Polarity means the north and south pole, they are fixed here. You can't change the north and south pole of a magnet. But in electromagnets, polarity can be changed. We can change the north and south pole. Change the direction of the current. After changing the direction of current, what will happen? North and south pole will be reversed, and because of which the polarity will also be changed. Okay, that's all about today's lecture. Anyone have any doubt? If you have any doubt, you can ask me. Otherwise, we will move on to the evaluation part. Okay, so let's move on to the evaluation part. So question number one is, name the two poles of a magnet. Yes, if you know the answer, you can raise your hands. Okay, Anjali, mute yourself, unmute yourself. And give
yes,
the
ma'am.
Answer.
The two poles of a magnet, the two poles of a magnet are south pole and north pole.
Okay, very good. Now the second question is, which rule is, please mute yourself. Which rule is used to determine the direction of magnetic field due to a electric current?
Miss, can I?
Answer. Yes, give the answer. If you are able to unmute yourself by yourself, you can unmute and you can give the answer. Yes,
okay, teacher. Right hand thumb rule.
Very good. Now, next question. Unlike poles of a magnet dash each other.
Miss, can I?
Yes.
South, the south or north, the south?
No, miss, attract.
Attract.
Yes. Unlike poles of a magnet attract each other. Now, question number four. If a bar magnet is suspended freely, in which direction it aligns itself?
Miss, can I?
Okay, give the answer.
North-south direction.
North-pole direction.
Yes, north and south direction. Very good. Question number five. The magnetic lines of force always originated from dash pole and end at dash pole of a bar magnet.
North pole and south pole.
Okay. Question number six. Who discovered the relation between electricity and magnetism?
Hans Christian Oersted.
Very good. Next question is, the strength of magnetic field is increased by increasing dash flowing in the conductor.
Current.
Very good. Current flowing in the conductor. Question number eight. As we go away from the conducting wire, the strength of magnetic field dash.
Is less.
Or we can say that it decreases. And question number nine. On increasing the number of turns in a circular coil, the strength of magnetic field dash.
Increases.
Very good. Now question number 10. Identify the figure shown.
Circular.
Magnetic field during current.
Magnetic field of a solenoid.
Yes, very good. This is a magnetic field produced by a solenoid. Okay, so that's all for today's lecture. If you have any doubt, you can ask me. If you didn't understand any point, anyone?
No,
it's clear. Okay, so that's all for today. We will meet tomorrow and continue the chapter. Okay, thank you then. Bye and take care.